All right. Cool. So, yes, as I mentioned earlier, I'm not Jan, but that doesn't really say who I actually am. That could be a large number of people. So, for those that don't know me, but I see a lot of familiar faces in here, I'm Adam Dupay. I'm an assistant professor here in CIDC. I work really closely with Jan. We co-direct the lab together and do a lot of research together. And today, what Jan wanted me to talk about and asked me to talk about today is, I know you guys have been doing a lot in terms of binary analysis and looking at different types of fuzzing techniques and how to essentially find vulnerabilities in a binary. And so what Jan wanted me to talk about, because what my PhD was on and what I still do research in, is how can we do the same thing in a web application? So how to automatically find vulnerabilities in a web application. So that's what, I don't know, so automated web vulnerability analysis is the name of the game. Cool. Okay. So what is vulnerability analysis?
Yeah. Finding vulnerabilities in some program or software.
What's a vulnerability?
Anything that is unexpected by, or unintended, I guess, by the original programmer.
Hmm. So if I make a typo in a dialog box, that is a vulnerability?
If your typo sets the buffer to -1,
a mistake that can be used maliciously.
Maliciously. What does malicious mean?
Something which was not the intention of developers and designers.
Something which was not intentional from the developers and designers? But what if, I mean,
and
unintentional behavior could be that it pops up a dialog box, right,
okay,
or something.
Anything that leads to an undesired state from confidentiality, integrity, and availability.
Right, so that's like more of the traditional definition, right? So there's ideas between confidentiality, integrity, availability, the CIA triad, which I'm sure you talked about. So let's think about something like this. So let's say I know of a web application that, and I found this behavior in this web application where anyone can change the content of any page in that application. Is that a vulnerability?
Yes.
Yes.
No.
Why yes?
Well, okay, it depends.
It depends, why does it depend?
Is it supposed to do that?
Is it supposed to do that, exactly, right? Wikipedia, that's the core functionality of Wikipedia. The fact that anyone can edit any page at any time is a feature of Wikipedia. And obviously they have access control mechanisms and they do have ways to lock pages, but fundamentally you can essentially do anything you want in a on Wikipedia. But if you find that same behavior now in CNN, where you can just edit the front page, right, that's a clear security vulnerability. So kind of when we think about vulnerabilities, I always want to keep in mind that context is incredibly important. So if you don't understand the application and what it's supposed to do, and this is actually one of the, I think the one of the main differences between some of the binary analysis stuff, at least as it currently is, and the web stuff, because a binary, you know, if you can corrupt some buffer on the stack, that's highly likely to be a security vulnerability. There's no way they intended that behavior, right? Like, oh yeah, we want, you know, an adversary to be able to control our instruction pointer. Like, no, that doesn't make any sense, right? But, and so that's what we need to think about. So, and vulnerabilities fall into essentially two classes, especially when we think about web vulnerabilities. And this gets conflated a lot, what I've seen when I talk to people and be like, oh yeah, right, well, anyways, we'll talk about it in a second. So, some vulnerabilities are known vulnerabilities, so these are ones that are already reported. Usually they will have a CVE number. What's the CVE stand for? Have you guys talked about CVE numbers or CVE?
Common Vulnerability Evaluations.
I actually don't know what the E stands for, but
Exposures.
There we go, I knew. So there's a basically a corporation, and I think in partnership with the Computer Emergency Response Team in the US, the US CERT. Basically, when you find a vulnerability, you can report it to them. They'll give you a number so that you can describe it, and then they can help you, or you can decide what you want to do about it. So some of the really cool ones are, like in 2013, there was this Ruby on Rails remote code execution. So Ruby on Rails had this functionality to do XML deserialization, and it also had a functionality where you could send an XML request to the Ruby on Rails server, and it would automatically perform XML deserialization if you sent XML to it. And it turns out the way Ruby did XML deserialization, you could instantiate arbitrary objects, which could then lead to arbitrary code injection. And this required no, it's a completely unauthenticated request. So you could just send this request to a web server and have full, essentially remote code execution. You know, these are all, and then the CVE will have more information, usually specifically about what versions are vulnerable. So for instance, like this CVE is Joomla 2.5x before 2.5.10 and 3.0x before 3.04 allow remote authenticated users to bypass intended privilege requirements. So why do they give all this information?
Well, because you know whether or not your system is vulnerable.
Yes, so this is part of the point of releasing these vulnerabilities, right? If you're an administrator of a system, let's say for a very large corporation that collects credit checks and credit informations on Americans, you could see, are we running Joomla 2.5.9? If so, then we're vulnerable. And either I need to apply the patch and upgrade, or I need to put some mitigations in place to make sure that this doesn't happen. And so these are what I, so previously, right, you can think of, and these are timestamps essentially, 2013, this was found in 2013. This is just an auto-incrementing number. So before 2013, like when, let's say, version 2.5.0 was released, right, this was an unknown vulnerability that nobody knew about in Joomla, right? But after, then it's now a known vulnerability that if you see that there's a version of Joomla 2.5.4, you know you can probably try to use this vulnerability against it. So the flip side there is unknown vulnerabilities. So this is some vulnerability exists in a custom web application. And like zero-day vulnerabilities, you don't have an assignment three, so don't worry about that. So what's a zero-day vulnerability?
It's an undisclosed vulnerability.
Why is it called a zero-day?
It's there since the start, and nobody knows, like, the good guys don't know that it's there.
Yeah, the way I think about it, there's been 0 days that the attackers have had to fix a vulnerability, whereas these ones are, say, N day, they've had N days. In this case, N is a very large number, right? It's 5 years to fix this vulnerability. Wow, sorry, I just noticed this. I guess a tablet, the writing tablets. That's super cool. Okay, anyways. I have one too, but I didn't bring it out. So this is actually, you know, for an organization, it actually doesn't matter, right? All you care about is what type of software are you running? Is it vulnerable? And if you're running known vulnerable stuff, you're already crap. So you should basically be fixing that stuff. So to me, the known vulnerabilities are less interesting, especially from a research standpoint of what we're trying to detect. What we want to detect is find unknown vulnerabilities. We want to find vulnerabilities in an application that nobody knows about, which is similar to binary analysis, right? Is in binary analysis, you know, you want to find, you're not necessarily or not yet trying to trigger some known vulnerability. You're trying to find a unique crash, a unique vulnerability in the application. So, how do you go about finding these vulnerabilities?
You could hire someone. You
hire someone, and then what? What do they do?
They're going to look for vulnerabilities. It's going to be expensive.
Yeah, it's gonna be, so you can hire, well, you can just hire someone, right? You can just hire some undergrad or something. You could hire somebody in this course, right? In this class who has some security training. You could hire a company who has security professionals. Yeah.
I'd start by figuring out what kind of software the web application's running.
Yeah, I mean, you'd wanna, so we're not talking yet about how, we're talking about ways to find vulnerabilities, kind of in the context of an organization. So yeah, so, you know, like essentially manual process, just like you can analyze a binary, you can find the vulnerabilities in a binary by looking through the disassembly. You can try to trigger those vulnerabilities. You can use tools like GDB to help debug it. You just pay people. Like, this is a common early night capitalist society. You just pay someone to make your problem go away, right? But it's super expensive. I mean, we're talking about, usually for an app, I don't know a rough I think it costs anywhere from probably, I'd say $5,000 to $50,000 or $100,000 for like a, depending on how long of an engagement, 1 week to, or 1 day to, you know, a few weeks. And so, because of that, if you're a company, you're a manager, or you're in charge of securing your organization, how often are you going to run these things?
How much money do I have?
Forced to?
Essentially, yes, as often as you're forced to by law or by your trade group, which that's part of, so PCI compliance is the, what is it, the processor card, payment card, what's the I stand for?
Initiative?
Yeah, that sounds good. So they, if you wanna have a company that touches or stores credit card data, you, the payment card company is like, I believe it's probably Visa, MasterCard, American Express. They have a list of standards that you must follow in order to do that. One of those standards is having, I believe, yearly pen tests of your system where you hire somebody to try to penetrate your network and then fix. So they're expensive. You have them maybe once a year if you're a good organization. And what do they actually tell you? So you get a report from them. They say, we found these five things. What do you do with that information?
Hire somebody to fix it?
Well, yeah, I mean, you should be able to fix it, or something your org should be able to, but yes, essentially, you need to fix those five things. What else does that tell you about your system? So now you fix those five things.
There's at least five things?
Yeah, there's at least five things, right? It doesn't actually tell you any information about the state of the network, right? Or the state of your system. So, and this is actually true of all types of vulnerability analysis, so this is something you should, just because run a fuzzer against your system doesn't mean that there are no vulnerabilities if it doesn't find anything, right? Similarly, you pay someone to find bugs in your system or do a pen test, and they may say there's 5 or 10 or whatever, but that actually has no bearing on how many there actually are in that application. The flip side of this is what you're learning in this class for binaries is develop tools that can do these things, right? Because humans are expensive, they, good humans cost a lot of money, and so, and how often do our systems change?
Every 2 years.
Yeah. Every 2 years?
It depends entirely on what you want to see.
I mean, in some organizations, I would believe that's true, but think about a website you use. How much does Facebook change? Like, hourly, I think, or daily, or something insane, yeah?
I think the best moment is to, before freezing the code, before, you know, releasing the new version, you must have a penetration test before that.
So Facebook releases every day, so you want to tell Facebook you should be stopping before every release and doing a pen test and hiring this professional firm to come penetrate your networks every day?
No, actually the penetration testers are part of the testing team, so in the SDLC, software development lifecycle, the test is an essential part before freezing the code.
Sure, so but now you, then you have, you're now essentially, rather than hiring somebody else, you're bringing them into your organization, and you're saying, do a penetration test every day. Can that be sustainable in a push code every, exactly, that's the problem, right? The problem is, exactly, and that's what companies do, is they do it every 6 months or every year, right? And so you get into this cycle where, yes, the penetration test does stuff, it finds, they find vulnerabilities, they find bugs, you fix them, but then now your code changes every day or every week or whatever your release cadence is. Your systems change, right? And so to me, that's one of the key reasons why you need automated tools, is because automated tools are something you can run after every code change and you can create as part of your software development lifecycle, right? You can't actually release code until it's been, until we've run some automated tools on it. So. This is why I find this area so interesting, is how to, I mean, there's intellectual challenges of how to create these tools, but they're also incredibly useful to an organization and a company to try to automatically find, and they're cheaper, right? You can run these, all it takes is CPU cycles, right, to find vulnerabilities. So compared to a human, and humans, for those who have never been in a company, humans are actually much more expensive than you think, like in a company. Right, because you're not just paying their salary, you're paying also their benefits, their the rest of the org to support them. It's usually, the rule of thumb I've heard is usually double the salary, and that's how much roughly a person costs the organization. So what we want is a list of vulnerabilities, right? So we just talked about this. When we fix all these vulnerabilities, we're definitely not secure because there's no guarantee that the human or the tool found all possible vulnerabilities in the system or software, right? If I run some web scanner, I run some fuzzer, even if it tells me, aha, here's 10 vulnerabilities, I fix them all, it doesn't guarantee anything. And even if, let's say, I mean, even if you have a super advanced tool that could theoretically find all possible, I don't know, cross-site scripting or whatever vulnerabilities, that doesn't mean that there aren't these type of logic flaw vulnerabilities where somebody could edit your page who's not supposed to, right? So there's, when you think of the class of vulnerabilities is huge, right? And then the subset inside there of the class of memory corruption vulnerabilities, right? And there's a class of SQL injection and a class of cross-site scripting. There's a whole lot of vulnerabilities that depend on the application itself. And also, you know, insider attacks, social engineering, right? These are all types of attacks that as an organization you need to be thinking about. So, and in the web, this is what, one thing why I like to explain this is a lot of professional people, when you say like, I do automated vulnerability analysis for the web, they're like, oh great, so you create a better tool like Nessus or a tool like that, which is looking for known vulnerabilities. So I think about these as kind of the, if you were relating it to like antivirus tools, it'd be like a signature-based antivirus where they just have a huge database of known vulnerabilities and say, if you make this request to this server and it tells you, like in the previous example, it's Joomla 5.0.4, then that's vulnerable and report that as a vulnerability. So they have signatures, they scan your network looking for signatures, and they only find, and this is the key, they can only find known vulnerabilities, right? They can only tell you, you are vulnerable to this vulnerability that's been released, right? They don't tell you anything about any, I think the way to think about this is they have no intelligence of their own, right? They're not actually thinking about or reasoning, they're just looking for signatures. And the other trick is, they can only find vulnerabilities that live on known or expected ports, right? So you gotta think about this, you're inside of a network or you're admitting a network, you have 1,000 machines or let's even scale it down, 100 servers, right? And you're gonna run a Nessus scan against all those servers. Are you gonna try every single combination of port and signature on every single machine? Because developers can often stand up, like, you have a Ruby on Rails app that's running on port 40,000 on some server that a developer created 3 years ago that nobody knows exists. So depending on your configuration, this vulnerability scanner might not find it. And this is actually, so there's some tools here if you want to look at them, Nessus, OpenVAS, and Saint. So this is actually a real example that I'm bringing up. So I did some pen testing for a company, and I ran the OpenVAS because it's part of the things you basically have to do as part of your pen test. So I ran the OpenVAS against their system. I configured it to make sure it was hitting every port, you know, UDP, TCP, everything. And it told me that their credit card processing server was vulnerable to an IPMI, known username password attack. So IPMI is the management protocol on a lot of servers. So if you don't know a lot of professional servers, because anybody who works with like servers in a server room, or have, no, I mean, not our server room, I mean something real. So you can't, so oftentimes servers are in a data center which is guarded and you have to have multiple biometrics to get in, and so you can't just physically go there and reboot the computer if it needs to be rebooted or to update, I don't know, various kinds of things. So there's actually a separate processor in a lot of servers that runs this IPMI, and you can connect to that remotely even if your actual server is completely stuck to do things like remote administration. And I could have done things like added a new kernel, so got completely root on their system that's processing credit cards. But as soon as we told them what we found, they said, don't do any of that because it's in production. It's processing credit cards. Like, that would be terrible for our business. And they were actually shocked that we found that, because they had set up Nessus to scan daily across their entire network. But their configuration was poor, and they weren't checking all the possible ports that they could and protocols. So yeah, they were really upset, but like, you know, the combination of glad we found it, but upset that it happened in the first place. And fundamentally, they can't find an unknown vulnerability, right? It doesn't make sense. There's no smarts here. But they definitely are useful, right? These are useful tools that can tell you, especially if you're doing this frequently, that, hey, you're running some known vulnerable version on your systems. And this is why I love automated vulnerability analysis. So we need to automatically find completely unknown vulnerabilities in typical software. But this is an overstatement, right? Like I said, we can't, I mean, we're not at a stage yet where we can just find any arbitrary vulnerability, right? We have to usually well define it into a specific vulnerability class. So yeah, usually we'll know, the class will know, okay, we can develop a tool to detect cross-site scripting vulnerabilities in a web application. It's probably impossible, but who knows what's gonna happen in like 20 or 30 years, so I don't know, that'd be crazy. So cheaper, scalable. One of the downsides though, and this is actually, so the tool can be wrong, right? A tool can, it's not a human, so it may be incorrect. It may say, I think there's a vulnerability here, and it may be up to a human to verify. Humans can also be wrong, and if you don't believe that, go look up some examples of really poor bug reporting on security bug bounty programs. There's some horror stories you can look at there of people who just like are, or actually I will, I think it's the, this was probably 2 or 3 years ago in a class, so I think the time has expired, but I had a student, so I gave them access to a server, and I said if you get root access on this server, like as the, you know, the root user, the admin user on the system, I'll give you massive extra credit points. So then I had a student email me, like, I got root on the server, and they sent me a screenshot, and it's because they had done ls-la/ like on the root. So they're like, I can see the root of the file system. I was like, I see that that's confusing, but this is not what we're talking about here. It's not eligible. So this is something we have to deal with. This is probably, I'd say, thinking about the binary analysis field where it is now, this is, one of the best things that they're at right now is actually verifying vulnerabilities by creating a proof of concept exploit. So that's part of why that's so important, is because you can say, look, I actually have a vulnerability and I've verified that it actually works, because here's the proof of concept that exploits this bug. So the key thing to think about, so a tool tells you that there's some vulnerability of some class, SQL injection, cross-site scripting. What are the possible outcomes? Or what are the, what's, not outcomes. So what are all the possibilities in regards to that output?
False positives.
I mean, what are, so what are some, so.
Do nothing.
A tool, okay, so let's think about this. So you, a tool tells you there's a vulnerability, right? Either there is a vulnerability, either it's correct, there is a vulnerability there, or it's incorrect, right? And so that's basically the two options when it tells you that there's a vulnerability. There's also the possibility that there exists a vulnerability somewhere else that the tool did not tell you about, right? So this was, so this is how we classify these things. So this is the way I always think about true positives and false positives. The true positive is a true report. It is actually vulnerable and the tool told you about it, right? So it's a vulnerability that the tool reports that's actually vulnerable. These are the best. These make you feel great because you don't have to spend time finding that and the tool found it. A false positive is when a tool reports a vulnerability that's not vulnerable, right? So this is terrible. This is, as a developer, this really erodes your trust in a tool because you just ran it, and then you have to spend time verifying, is this actually vulnerable? And you look through code paths, and you try out some exploits, and you realize it's not actually vulnerable. Why am I wasting my time tracking down these not vulnerable these false positives. And finally, false negatives. So this is what we're talking about with, once you run any tool, you actually have no guarantees about any other vulnerabilities that exist on the system. So these are real vulnerabilities that the tool missed. All right. Yeah, so false positive rate. Okay, so we're gonna talk about two basic types here. Good, we're doing good, okay. So when I think of web vulnerability analysis, there's two main types here, black box and white box. So a black box tool has completely, so analyzes a web application by issuing HTTP requests to the application, getting some HTML responses back, and maybe making some more to try to find the vulnerability. So I think of the black box as simulates basically a human hacker who's external to your org as much as possible. So this is, the tool is essentially has, so the key is, has no access to source code. So the tool has no idea, and one of the beauties of the web, which we won't get into, is that you can write a web application in any language. You can write Python, PHP, Ruby, C code. I know one year, Jan coded the ICTF registration page in a bash script. So yes, that probably doesn't surprise you. And the really awesome thing for black box tools is they can find a vulnerability in a specific class against a remote web server without knowing or caring about the server-side language, right? So this is, and I think of this as, in terms of binaries, it's essentially, you can think of, so a lot of the binary analysis basically requires that they can analyze the binary code, right? So they need to understand the either x86, x86-64, the MIPS, ARM, whatever code, so they can fuzz it, or actually maybe that's not true. Okay, flip it back. So black box, I think, is very similar to just straight fuzzing of just throw input at a binary, see if it crashes. Right, if it crashes, then that's your signal that yes, that input triggered some vulnerability or likely triggered some input. The newer stuff where you're doing symbolic execution and understanding the path of the program, those type of things rely much more on you being able to understand the binary, because if you have some binary that you don't know what it does, then your fuzzer can't work on there, right? Or your symbolic execution engine can't work. These black box tools, the key paradigm is that they cannot, I mean, they have no access to the source code at all. So they're using the application just as a user would. Whereas on the flip side, in static analysis tools, so most, the benefit we have is a lot of the web languages are written in scripting languages. So what's the difference between like a scripting language like Python or PHP and C?
You get the result right away.
You get the result right away, how? Yeah, but how? Why?
There's a runtime.
There's a runtime?
Supports
C has a runtime language.
Python's interpreted.
It's interpreted, yes. The key is that there's an interpreter, right? The Python program is an interpreter which inputs a Python program, creates the abstract syntax tree, and then starts essentially executing it or
converts into bytecode.
Yes.
Runs it in a virtual machine.
I forgot that. Yes, converts it into bytecode, but doesn't actually execute, it doesn't translate it directly to x86 assembly that the CPU can actually execute, right? So it's interpreting those bytecode instructions, similar to Java, right? You write a Java program, you can compile it into a class file, but then that's interpreted by the Java VM. Are we talking about that? Oh, because, so this, what this means is most web applications, because you gotta think, so they're accessed over the network, right? So you have some application running somewhere, it's accessed over the network. So, I don't know, what's, like, so you need, let's see, at least 3 round trips to initiate a TCP connection to a server. So that's, I don't know what, like, I don't know, I will give make up numbers, but that time it takes to set up the connection is going to be overshadowed by the time it takes to process the request, right? So you can make if you write rewrite your application from PHP to C, right, you may be able to make that request slightly faster, but overall it's going to be roughly the same because you're mostly dominated by that. And actually, you're also dominated a lot by the database as well. So so the language doesn't matter. And A, if the language doesn't matter, because anybody in any operating system running any web browser can access your web application, then you're actually not tied to a specific language like C or C++ that's going to be compiled that they're going to run locally. So this means when we do white box analysis, it means we look at the source code of the application to identify vulnerabilities. And this is tied to a specific programming language and possibly a vulnerability class. So you can write a tool that analyzes, let's say, PHP code and looks for SQL injection vulnerabilities, which is great if you have a web application that uses PHP. But if you wrote your application in Bash, you can't find any vulnerabilities there. Right? Your tool, the tool is essentially useless. And because there's this huge range of, I mean, PHP is still the dominant language, but there's a lot, JavaScript, I think, is the new up-and-comer, where people are using Node.js to write web applications. You have JavaScript running both on the server side and the client side. So I'll briefly talk about black boxes, what we're going to dive into today. Assuming, how long do I have? 1:15? Okay, cool. So black box tools are, well, they have been very dumb. They basically act similar to a human. They crawl the web application. Why do they crawl the application? What does crawling mean?
Exploring all the links, basically.
Yeah, exploring all the links in the application, right? Preferably just on that application, right? If you want to limit your scope. So you crawl all the links. So why crawl all the links?
Increase the attack surface.
Increase, can you increase the attack surface?
Discover the attack surface. Your knowledge of the
discover,
attack surface.
Discover, yes. You increase your knowledge of the attack surface, right? The important thing to think about, just like a binary, right? If a binary is reading from any of the argument vectors, right, that's a potential way your input can get into the application. Or if a binary is reading from a file, that's where you can maybe put input. Or if a binary is reading from a network socket, that's where you can put input. So it all comes back to the concept of injection vectors. Like, what are all the ways that an attacker could get malicious data into this application? Similar thing with a website. You want to know, where are all the places that I can give input to the application? Turns out crawling is actually not enough, just in the sense that you don't really know in a black box manner what the application's actually doing on the other side. Maybe it's taking tweets from a Twitter account and then using that as its output. Or maybe it's talking to third-party APIs, which you could inject data into that will eventually go into the application. So even just crawling itself is not necessarily enough, but it's the start. I mean, you have to do this to, discover the attack surface or kind of explore the attack surface. And then you essentially fuzz it. So it's actually not that different, except in the fact that a lot of these tools basically have they say, hey, if you're looking for SQL injection, here's 20 possibilities. And if any of these, and then they have some way to detect on the response whether that was correct or not. So you basically, when you're fuzzing, it's the same concept with binaries. You're trying to trigger a vulnerability. In the binary case, you're wanting to trigger a crash. Here, it depends on the class. So a SQL injection, you're usually trying to trigger some kind of SQL error. And on the other side, cross-site scripting, you're trying to look for your output in the correct way to execute JavaScript. And then you need to analyze. So you need to figure out if the fuzz attempt was successful. In binaries, this is trivial, essentially. Right? Just fuzz and fuzz and fuzz and see, did you get the seg fault? Right? And then you can work from there. With the web, it's a little bit more complicated, although not, I'd say. It really comes down to the vulnerability class. So it depends on the intrinsic properties of that vulnerability. So instance, like we talked about, the editing, arbitrarily editing a web page's content, right? You could develop a tool to detect that, but detecting whether if that's intended functionality or not is a very tricky problem. So this analysis problem is the difficult part. So this is the way I normally think about a web application. So this is going to be a super abstracted view. So you have here we're gonna have this tool or this web application vulnerability scanner. We have our web server running some server-side code, in this case PHP, talking to some back-end database, let's say MySQL. So anybody do web programming here or have done? So what type of things are missing from this diagram?
Usually you have Nginx in the front, you know, reverse proxy, some caching stuff.
Yeah, so caching, that's a huge one. So there may be, there may be caches actually at any point in between here. There may be like a deliberate memcache server that the application's using. There may be, oftentimes the main one is you actually want multiple copies of your application so you can load balance between them. So you have an Nginx server or something else that's doing the load balancing between all of those. What else? JavaScript, yeah, so you know this actually assumes that the PHP code contains all of the application's logic and just spits out a web page. But modern web applications, think of them, they actually split their logic in client-side code that's delivered to the browser through JavaScript and the server-side code that's running on the server. So that's another aspect that we're gonna ignore for now. What else?
All the third-party API servers.
Yeah, any third-party APIs that it could hit, or logging or monitoring that it's doing. The database, so this is the standard LAMP stack, is Linux, Apache, PHP, and MySQL, right? But you can have more than one MySQL. You can have a cluster of servers, so you have some increased availability. You could be using something, I was gonna say a disparaging remark, but you could use something like a NoSQL database, like MongoDB or something like that, or you could even be not using a database, you could be using files on the local system, like, you know, all kinds of, the configurations are endless because the user using this does not care at all about that, right? The user only cares about that they get an HTML web page back that their browser understands. So you can do all this crazy complicated architecture. And you can even have multiple copies of this in different availability zones across different networks for greater availability purposes. Anyways, but we don't care about any of that, so that was a great digression. We just treat that as a black box, right? The tool doesn't care what it's running, and all it's gonna do is make HTTP requests and get HTML responses back with usually some style sheets and some JavaScript code. And then it has to essentially extract all the links in the HTML that point to other pages inside the web application and follow those and issue more requests. So go down and fuzz there and then eventually trigger the existence, or basically not trigger, infer the likely existence of a bug in the application. So one of the key problems is obviously false negatives, similar with fuzzing, what we just talked about, right? It can never, and the key problem is, so like, how do we know we've exercised all the functionality of the application? Yeah?
In the same diagram, what do you mean when we are scanning from one place to the other? For example, you had made the request, and then you said, go and make the request somewhere else.
Yep.
See if you can crack the bug.
There are three things that are incredibly important to web security. URLs, because a URL tells you how to make a request to the web server, and specifically, it tells you how to make an HTTP request. And then the HTTP response contains HTML, which contains links, including URLs, which tell you how to make new HTTP requests and get new HTML. So it's all driven by URLs. So in this sense, I like to think of it as a web application is actually an easier to explore GUI in some sense for a computer, right? So you have, it turns out even though it may be slightly counterintuitive when you're running an application on your machine, let's say like running some code or creating a tool that can try to automatically exercise all the parts of, let's say, an Android app or your GUI like Excel is incredibly difficult because the developer has 100% freedom on how that drop-down menu works. You can try to use things like in Windows COM to try to interrogate, but fundamentally they can draw it like whatever they want. Think of like a game. Right, you have a game menu where you press escape, the game menu shows up. That's not using any Windows rendering to get that. It's drawing all those pixels, basically. Whereas here, in order for your website to actually work and for people to use it, you know, how do you know how to interact with the website? Never thought about it before. Doing it for so long.
Standards, HTTP,
HTTP. How do you know as a human? You don't look at that, do you?
Rarely.
Your web browser presents an interface based on
HTTP. And then what do you do?
Click on stuff.
Yeah, you look for things to click on, right? And when you dig into the implementation, you know it's all links and forms. That's essentially it. You can click on anything that's a link, and you can fill out anything that's a form, and those make new web requests. So from the interesting thing is from the web application's perspective, it actually doesn't care about any of those links or anything, right? Because all it cares about is the HTTP request, which contains the URL you're trying to access, and then any form data that you're trying to send as well. So this is what we're crawling in sense there. And this is, as we'll see, this is how basic tools work, is they just want to crawl the whole thing, get every single URL that's inside that application, and fuzz every single parameter with every single vulnerability that they have. So white box tools, I want to talk about them briefly, because I do think they're super cool. Unlike, I think, essentially, it's also has to do with the difference between dynamic analysis and static analysis. So have you guys talked about the difference there?
Static, yeah.
Can somebody refresh me?
Between dynamic and static analysis?
Dynamic analysis and static analysis, yes.
So static analysis looks at what the code says. Dynamic analysis looks at what the code does.
Yeah, that's pretty good. I would agree with that. Yeah, I'd probably also add that essentially, so in some sense, here with this black box tool, the dynamic analysis in the sense that the application must be running somewhere, and it must be configured and set up properly and have whatever databases it needs because we're interacting with the actual application, right? Whereas with a static analysis tool, a white box tool, we just need the PHP code. I actually don't care about instantiating the database or anything. I can just essentially look at the code, and the idea is not execute the code, right? So these can be super simple. You can implement a static analysis tool as a grep. You can grep for things that you know are known vulnerable. But so cross-site scripting is when you use user input in the HTML response. And a classic way of looking for this is just echoing. So this $_get is the PHP way to access any get parameters that are passed in the URL. So in the URL, after the question mark, you have a series of key value pairs. So key equals value separated by the ampersand. So all those key value pairs get put in here. So if you look through this, and you can do this on GitHub, you can find multiple examples of vulnerable code. That's always a vulnerability. You can look at syntax, so you can look at vulnerable code patterns. There's a lot of work here which you can do on looking for maybe crypto style vulnerabilities by saying like, oh, if you use crypto with ECB rather than CBC, that ECB is pretty much inherently vulnerable, so that's a problem, so you could look for that. Or you can statically analyze the code and try to understand if the code contains vulnerable behavior. So in the case of cross-site scripting, the question you want to ask is it ever possible or user input to go from the user to output in the HTML without being sanitized properly? And that's the question you want to ask. So you look through that, through the control flow graph on all program paths, essentially. And to do this is complicated and super cool, but I'm not going to talk about it there. It's also impossible, so which is good, right? Otherwise, we'd just be done with security. So actually, it's really easy. So I can, who's gonna pay me money for a tool that will tell them every single cross-site scripting vulnerability in their PHP applications? How much money would you pay for that? I guarantee I will find every vulnerability. Zero false negatives, which I said were one of the worst things. Zero false negatives.
I would pay nothing because you're gonna give me all false positives.
No, I'll give you some true positives too.
Yes.
Yeah, so you should pay me nothing because I can give you a tool that every single line of code I say, there's a cross-site scripting vulnerability. Oh, this line that's just a curly brace, there's a cross-site scripting vulnerability. There's a cross-site scripting vulnerability. right? I can do that, and within there, there will be every cross-site scripting vulnerability in your program. There will also be a huge percentage of false positives. So the goal, right, it's important to understand, the goal we're trying to do is 100% true positives, which inherently means 0% false positives, based on how those work, and 0% false negatives. So this is actually provably impossible, which is cool. So I'll briefly sketch it a little bit. Essentially, you reduce it to the halting problem. So what's the halting problem?
Will the program stop?
Yes. So the idea is, it will, if I give you an arbitrary program P, can you tell me if this program will halt on every possible input? Will this program halt in the sense that it will not loop forever? Will it halt on every possible input?
It's supposed to be with the given input. You have the halting method H that takes in P and I, where P is the program and I is the input to the program.
And the way they prove it was sense the program.
I
think it's a generalized input, because if you can just say, does this halt on this input, you can just execute it. I mean, I guess.
Because the way they prove that that's not provable is having a specific input.
You can't just execute it though, because it could run forever.
Yes, that's I think the key problem.
Yeah.
Okay. But I think the trick there is the other person can choose the input, right? So
yes.
They can.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll just generalize it there for now. Because I'm stealing this proof from here, so go read this proof, because I'm not a halting theorist or a prover. I don't know. But the idea is, okay, so let's say, actually this is relevant for you all because you're thinking about binaries. So the idea is, if you have C code, could you create a tool to 100% tell you that all array accesses are correct or not? So we want to do bounds checking, essentially, array out of bounds. So we want to say, for every single array access in our program, is this safe, right? That's classic array out of bounds, classic memory corruption vulnerabilities. So you basically need to prove that if you can do this static analysis, then you can solve the halting problem. So that's the brief outline of this proof. So assume we start, right, we're going to prove by contradiction. We assume first that we have the perfect static analysis that can detect array out of bounds. So you give it a program, it 100% tells you every single array access and every single, that are actually vulnerable, and it has zero false negatives, so it finds them all, and it tells you no wrong answers. Everybody good? So the way you do that, so what you do then, is you first then take the program, replace every array access with a bounds check that does if I is greater than or equal to 0 and I is less than the length of the array, then access it, otherwise exit. So we're going to replace every array access with this. Therefore, if we have an array access out of bounds, it will terminate the program. Right, so this false condition of this branch will exit the program.
Cool.
Now, then transform every actual exit of the program with an explicit array out of bounds. So change every exit with a deliberate array out of bounds. Then run your perfect static analysis algorithm on the program. If the static analysis says that there are no array out of bounds, right, because those are the original exits of the program, it means that we will not hit any of the original exits of the program, which means that the program does not halt. If the static analysis says that there are array out of bounds access, then the original program does halt, which means we solve the halting problem. Because we can use that perfect static analysis tool to create a program that solves the halting program. All you have to do is give me a program P, I do this transformation, and I run my static analysis tool on it. No questions on this, read the blog post. No, you can ask me, but don't expect an answer. Yes.
Couldn't you just have inside that program that you're doing the essay on, couldn't you just have if essay is true, then run forever? Because that's how they prove that you cannot prove the halting problem. Couldn't you just do that in this one too?
I think what you're trying to do here is reduce the problem of detecting perfect static analysis to will this program halt or not by essentially flipping the conditions, right, and saying that every exit I'm going to put an array out of bounds, and every access I'm going to protect every access so that out of bounds check causes it to exit. And then, so yeah, you're essentially, because you have like the, yeah.
So then it could further reduce it to that problem that he's
yes,
talking
you
about.
Yes, and then that's what you're saying there is there. And the halting problem proves its own thing, right? So you assume with this that the halting
problem is not
solvable, right? So there we've reached a contradiction in our proof, because we started with the assumption that we have a perfect static analysis tool. And then we get to this point that says we can't have a perfect static analysis tool because you just solved the halting problem.
Got it.
Wait. So, yes, please.
Sorry, I'm just a little bit confused, because wouldn't our static analysis tool always return that there are array out of bounds, because we've added specific array out of bounds, so it'll go ahead and say, yes, there are array out of bounds at this point, this point, this point, this point.
I see. A perfect tool will tell you, no, it doesn't just tell you there could be. So if you have a, let's say, an if false branch and then an array out of bounds, that's actually not a vulnerability because it can never be triggered by code. So it's about the path through the program as well. So you want to say, like, the way other way to think about it, especially when you're thinking about binaries and fuzzing and states and all that thing, is starting from, you know, the initial program state, is it ever possible for this program to reach a state where there's an array out of bounds? And if you never execute that code, then that's fundamentally not possible. I agree you'd want to clean that up, though. That's where it gets tricky, yes. So I'd agree that, yes, a practical tool, you'd want that, but for more technical terms, you'd say that it's not really a vulnerability because an attacker can't exploit it. I guess it's like if a tree falls in the woods, just make it sound, right? It's like that's why you want to fix it, because it's potentially vulnerable if the control flow ever changes to execute down that program path. But as it stands right at that moment, there's no vulnerability there. Good question. All right. So, do we just give up and throw up our hands?
Yes.
No. So we can't have it all. We either have to have false positives or false negatives, right? And this is, that's really just the decision. So. I realize we're kind of running out of time, so I want to talk about some research stuff. But the idea is, if you have no false negatives, then that means your tool is sound in some sense. I mean, not in some sense, a very specific sense, but usually with caveats. Like in a modern language, it's very hard to make this claim. Even something like analyzing Java code, because you can have reflection to dynamically load code at runtime, and so after you have that, statically you can't tell what code is being loaded, and so now you have no idea of what the program's behavior is. So the other way is no false positives, and this means the technical term is complete. So tools you have to figure out which way you want to go, and this is what I meant, where the nice thing with binary analysis is saying you have no false positives essentially means that you do that by verifying every single vulnerability report that you report. And when you think about more of a practical tool, you can even then sort your vulnerabilities, right? You can say, these are the ones I've definitely confirmed with static analysis, or with, exploit generation, and here's the proof of concept. These are ones I think are vulnerable, but I couldn't prove it, but maybe that's useful information to you. So why not use both? Why not use a static analysis tool to tell you where all the vulnerabilities are, and then use a dynamic tool to then exercise those vulnerabilities to generate like a proof of concept?
Some tools do that.
Can we just go over that?
Hmm?
Some tools do that.
Yeah, some tools do that, but why? And think about it in the web context, not the binary context. It gets a little blurry there because you have the binary code. So you can look into it and do some static analysis very easily. But here, a black box tool fundamentally can't. Like, can you take a web black box tool which doesn't care about source code, and then take a static analysis tool that does care about source code, maybe use the static analysis to find vulnerabilities, and then pass that to the black box tool to verify?
Want to install under a black box. box.
Exactly, yes. So these are kind of people trying to make up a term of gray box tools, but they really have the worst of both worlds. Right? You have the fact that you still are only tied to one language and one runtime, and then you also need this other black box component to verify. So it's probably one of these things where it's probably more practical in some sense, but in my opinion, it's just lame. Like, I feel like we should be improving both tools rather than trying to mix them in ways that don't make sense, where they just inherit the weaknesses of each other. Cool. Okay. Yeah, so static analysis is really cool. I've done some work on static analysis, and we are doing work here. It's really cool because you're trying to understand, essentially over-approximate the behavior of a program. So somebody gives you a program, and you have to figure out what can this program do. What are all states the program could be in? And so it must be either essentially an under-approximation or an over-approximation. Right? So we either need to say, well, this could be a vulnerability, but maybe not, because I don't know if maybe this path through the control flow graph is not valid. All right. So I want to get into research here. So the goal, basically, of the research inside automated vulnerability analysis is basically you want to try to increase effectiveness by decreasing false negatives, decrease errors, and develop brand new tools to find new classes of vulnerabilities or errors in other types of systems. So I want to talk, because we've got 15 minutes, so I want to talk about some of the research that I've done in this area to give you an idea of what are some of the things, because this is more of a researchy focused seminar. Question mark, or maybe not, I don't know. So black box web application vulnerability scanners. So these are the tools, and the other way I forgot to mention them are point and click tools, where you put in a URL, you click go, and they find all the vulnerabilities in that website. There are a number of tools that are on here. They cost anywhere from, I think, Burp Proxy is free to use, a limited version, which is still super functional, and I actually use the free version. But the full version is, I think, only like $300, whereas like Acunetics and some of the other ones are like in the tens of thousands of range. And it depends on your license, too. So you could buy a pen testing license that allows you to run it against any URL, and that's about 10 grand, or you can get a version that only works with a given URL, so basically it's like hard-coded against your software for less money, but I don't know. These prices may have gone up too. So we wanted to ask the research question of how effective are these tools, right? And it's actually, when you think about it, it's kind of a tricky problem. So how would you say that one tool is better than the other? So let's think of a hypothetical scenario. I tell you that the Burp proxy found 5 vulnerabilities and Acunetics found 10 vulnerabilities. Which one's better? Depends on maybe the severity of the vulnerabilities they found. What else could it depend on?
It could be false positive.
Yeah, false positive.
It could be false positive. Just because it reported a vulnerability doesn't mean anything. What else?
0-day vulnerabilities.
They're all 0-day vulnerabilities. These are all unknown vulnerabilities.
Does the speed matter, like how fast?
How long did it take them to find the vulnerability? That's usually, as an academic, I would say it's less important, because you could always just run this with more cores. And you know, if it takes me a day, it's an automated tool, right? So you can create a test app. But yes, that is something that is important. Yeah.
The code coverage.
Code coverage in what sense?
Because they want to generate some inputs, and so based on these inputs, they should, you know, follow some, for example, text or strings in the program, and if these texts change, so how much these two page, you know, changed based on the...
Oh, even with code coverage, let's say the tool that found 10 vulnerabilities only exercised 25% of the code, but the tool that found 10 only exercised 10% of the code. What do you mean?
Total number of vulnerabilities that exist in whatever you're throwing it at. Like, how many, was it out of 1,000 that were there?
Exactly. So, yeah, and the other thing nobody mentioned is what's the overlap, right? So, did Burp found the exact 5 that's inside the set of the 10 that the other one found? Are they completely distinct sets, in which case that's interesting? Is there overlap there? And furthermore, it's hard to say whether 10 is good because it sounds good. It sounds like a high number, right? 10 vulnerabilities. But if there's 50 that exist in this program, they only found 1/5 of the vulnerabilities. Or if there's 100 that exist, right, each tool only scratched the surface of the vulnerabilities. So, and using off-the-shelf software, it's essentially impossible to answer that question, right, of how many. So if I gave you a version of WordPress and say, run all these tools against WordPress, how do you evaluate the false negative rate? Because that's an important part. So what we did is we developed our own custom software that had known vulnerabilities that we inserted. So this is Wacko Pico, the website that we created. I think it has, I have to look at the notes, I think it's something like 16 intentional vulnerabilities. And we also wanted to test the scanners across those axes we talked about. So we had some crawling challenges. For instance, the what's going on today gives you a link to a calendar that's an infinite calendar. It keeps going forever. The tools, there's a login functionality, so there's vulnerabilities behind the login form to seeing can they, and some of the tools actually did create user accounts and logged in and crawled and fuzzed that part of the application. There's things here like this is JavaScript, so this was created dynamically by JavaScript, so if the tool didn't support JavaScript, it wouldn't find that. So there's all different types here, and this was actually taken from a guy who's French who created this picture. So 16 vulnerabilities across, and we also wanted to not just test the standard SQL injection and cross-site scripting, but also things like command injection, where a user can, or where an attacker can essentially inject like command line, the input is used into something like system. Oops. And so they can, yes, this happens a lot. So they get remote code execution on your server. We had a weak session where the session ID in one part of the website was generated just, the session ID was not random, it was auto-incrementing, so you could access other people's sessions. We had our admin area of the website had the username and password of admin. Parameter manipulation, this is where there were private parts of the website, but by changing the parameters there, you could access somebody else's information, which actually, so this was something that we found in a company doing a pen test where they had their credit card records and the link to the PDF of one company's credit card report was some long number. And so we tried, what if you change that number up and down? And then we started getting other people's reports of their credit card receipts, basically. And so we sucked all those down to include in a report. File exposure, if there's any using directory traversal attacks, so directory traversal, file exposure. And we had a logic flaw. So the logic flaw here was there was a coupon code where you enter and it could drive, you could keep entering it to drive the price down to zero. So this is something, of course we didn't expect them to find, but it's something that is a realistic vulnerability that occurs, and so we wanted to see. We actually also, so when we created this website, we gave it to the hacking group at UC Santa Barbara, and we let them, and they found, I believe, 15 out of the 16 vulnerabilities. Maybe even all of them, I actually can't remember, but yeah, they found all of the vulnerabilities, which was awesome. And then we ran 11 tools against the website to try to figure out how they did. So the lowest, this was a really terrible one, only around 10%, but the highest were only around not even 40% of that found actual, and these are after false positives are all removed and everything. And so no tool found more than 40% of the vulnerabilities. And even, I believe, even altogether, so across all tools, unioning the set of all vulnerabilities, I don't think it passed 50%. So they missed a lot of vulnerabilities. I'm not gonna go into them here. And they had false positives ranging from 0 to 200 plus, which was insanely annoying to deal with and go through those results. The average was about 25. One was a server path disclosure where they'd say you're leaking paths about the server and like /var/something, but that was input from the scanner that was being used in the output. like it was like cross-site scripting vulnerability. So they were injecting their own input and thinking they were disclosing local paths on the server, which was not true. So they're easy to scan out. So like the actual false positives that were interesting was, so they would say that like, oh, there's a cross-site scripting on this page, but there wasn't. And like, they'd be like, oh, there's this PHP eval injection vulnerability, which there was not. And so, so this is kind of an interesting point where they're, you know, you're actually expecting for these tools the false positives to be pretty low because they're, you know, sending some input, triggering a vulnerability, but that analysis component of figuring out why it was or was it vulnerable was not very good. And so what we did is we actually had an interesting problem of, we looked at, well, how do you say when one is better than the other? So we actually, I took this from when I was taking like a theory class, and we were learning about like a lattice. Have you guys talked about like lattices at all yet? I don't think you will, but maybe. The basic idea is, so this is ordered in terms of, we created a metric called dominates. So the idea is one, so when, I guess it's an interesting question. When can you definitively say that one tool is better than another?
When it finds all the superset?
If it finds a superset of vulnerabilities. And the other thing that I didn't mention was we actually ran each of these tools in three different configurations. So not just, we ran it in point and click, we ran it in a configuration mode where we put in a valid username password so it can exercise more of the website. And we ran it in a mode where most of these tools have a manual proxy mode. So you set up the proxy and then you use the website through the proxy as a human, and then it figures out what's going on from there. So then the other flip side is not only did it find the same vulnerabilities or more, but also found it at a lower level. So if like I found it on a point and click, but the other tool found the same vulnerability after manual analysis, that tool's not as good. So anyways, that's just a little caveat that I remembered here. So this is the dominates graph. So the tool's on the top, and this is the number of vulnerabilities I believe that they, oh, no. Is that the number of vulnerabilities that they found?
Yeah.
No, that can't be right.
Did you say Grendel scan did the worst?
It definitely did the worst. It's maybe a rank ordering? Okay, ignore that number. Because Burp. Now I'm curious.
It was the same as the...
Did it have the same percentage?
Yeah,
I just want to check.
It looked about the same.
Okay, yep. All right, great. Okay. Yeah, so the idea is they all found, so the interesting thing is those four tools all found the same six vulnerabilities, but didn't overlap, like none of them found more or better than the other. They actually, and even NSTOCKER is interesting because it found a vulnerability, I believe, that nobody else found, but it missed the stuff that Grendel scan found, because otherwise it would have dominated that, right? So super interesting here, and this is kind of an interesting way to think about these tools and what they can do. So anyways, I'm not gonna talk about this, but we actually went through and we looked at all of the requests that they made and all the payloads that they sent to try to understand more stuff about there. But the biggest problem was the login page. The biggest problem was that the tools, and we saw this, is the tool would be crawling, fuzzing the app, and even if we told it necessarily how to log in, it would maybe end up logging itself out while it was doing its testing. So what we realized is these tools take this shotgun approach where they just blast requests at the application without and get a bunch of responses back and try to determine that something has a vulnerability. But if this request logs you out of the application, now you're no longer testing the application essentially in that same state. So if you think about code paths, right? This change, so all of these requests, even though you're testing the same input with the same vulnerability class, all of these requests, you're now going through a different code path. And that's the fundamental problem, is these tools were created in a way that they thought of the web application as this dumb thing that just takes input and gives them output. Yeah.
Why these tools are somehow state agnostic? They cannot.
Because they are. That's what they. That's wrong. I mean, that's what we're going to talk about in a second. Yeah. So that's what we identified as the main problem, is that they essentially, state agnostic is a good term, right? they don't even think that they're talking really to an application in some sense. They just think they're talking to, this is why I use the term web application all the time instead of a website. Like a website to me is just something that has static HTML pages and just gives you output. Whereas like an application is something you deal with and interact with, and it has a session and it has state and all those nice things. And so the idea is, so for like a simple web application, thinking about state, so let's say there's an application where you access home.php, that's the main page, that has a link to login. Then after you access login, now you can access the view.php page, which is now a link on home.php. And now you can access those pages of view and logout. So the idea that we had is, can we create a black box tool that can automatically infer this state machine or these state transitions? And what we thought of, so we first thought, okay, abstractly, this is essentially, if you think of what's the state of the application, right? There's a guest and a logout state, or a guest and a user state. So you first access home, and you can do that as many times as you want, you stay in the same state. Then you access login, and that transitions you to a new state where you can continue accessing home as many times as you want, right? It doesn't transition you out. You can now access the view page, and then you can log out and go back to the guest state. So the idea, and a key thing here that we can see is, A, if you can never log in, you can't fuzz or test view.php, so you'll never find vulnerabilities here. And it's possible, although we don't know, it's possible that home.php is executing different code in these different states, right? So we'd want to test it in both of those states. And so what we realize is this is actually, we can use a, has anyone, so you've heard of automata, right?
Yeah.
So there's a similar type of model of a machine called a Mealy machine, where in every state you have the input, which is, let's say, home.php, like the request, and the thing after the slash is the output. So the idea is, in the guest state, when you make a home.php request, you get output HTML page A. And then when you do login.php, you make output B. And then in the user state, you now get home.php will give you C, and you can access view.php, which gives you D. So the idea is, we realize if we can model, use this as a model, we can actually use this to infer what state the application is in a completely black box manner. And the reason is, so why is the output for home.php different in guest and user?
Because
there's a link to view.php. So I know if I make a request, so the core idea of a Mealy machine is, if an application is in a given state and you make a given request, you will get that response back, A. So if I knew this in advance, I could access the home page and know which state I'm in between A or C. But we can't know that. What we can do is, we can crawl the application. We can crawl the application, get some HTML back A. We can crawl the login page, get back B. Crawl the home page, get back C. And crawl the view page and get back D. And this is the core idea. So we first crawl the application, getting a series of input-output pairs. We then look, when did we make identical requests and get different responses? Then we know that the state must have changed between those responses, but we don't know which requests changed the state. So then we need some heuristics to try to identify which, because there could be 20 requests that we made. So we don't actually know which one transitions. Yes?
Even you can use the cookies, because maybe the session cookies changed, you know, in this way. And you are logged in, so you get a new cookie.
Yeah, that's tricky, though. I would. We actually tried to not rely on any cookies, because
people want to parse all of these, you know, lines of the HTML, consider it has 1,000 of lines, so it's very hard to find that.
Oh, those are easy. So we'll talk about that in a second, actually. But the cookies are actually tricky, because most PHP applications, as soon as you do start session, you get cookies, and those never change. Right, so the mechanism of how the state is done is kind of, it's nice, we actually developed a process agnostic of that. We actually don't care. And the idea is, okay, we first need to decide, this exact thing of, is A and C different? And there's actually a lot of difficult problems here with when you have advertisements, which we're not really concerned about. The other thing is with this model, so we're thinking about no external. So the only thing that changes the state is our request. So kind of a simplistic model, but it still kind of works, yeah.
Are you only looking at the response body? You're not looking at the full response, like the headers or anything in the response?
Headers come.
No, we're only considering the HTML of the page.
Do you have some kind of smarts that determine relevant? What if they put current time on the page?
Yes, that's a huge problem. We ignored that just to see if we could do it first. So we actually changed some applications to remove time-based components. But I think it's one of those things you could add over time. And one of the ideas, and what we realized actually, I think our key insight in detecting if A or C was different is not to use the text of the page, because the text of the page matters a lot less. What matters is, so the key difference between the home and these two states is the fact that there's a new link to view.php, and the links and forms on the page define what you can do with the application. Right? So when there's a new link to a new part of the, when the link structure changes, the application has changed because essentially your GUI has changed. Right? You now have a new button that you've never seen before. Yeah.
What's your approach for URL rewriting or even parameter manipulation? I mean, if
it's tricky, but yes, we did cover that. I will talk about it very briefly. I'm actually over time, but I'll just finish these thoughts up. We need to do a couple things. We need to first figure out these similar pages, if A and C are actually the same page or different. Like I said, we know that the state must have changed, but we need to try to determine which request changed the state. This actually, we use a lot of heuristics here, like a post request is more likely than a get request, and a whole bunch of heuristics. And then, at this point, we actually just have you can think of it as a chain. So we know we were in state zero, and now we see, oh, state change, but we don't actually know, are we flipping between two states? So then we have to have a way to essentially collapse those onto itself, and we use a graph coloring algorithm based on trying to determine which states can't possibly be the same based on some techniques we developed. But I'm only going to talk about clustering similar pages. So the idea is we use the links and forms on the page, and we actually develop a tree out of this as well as all of the parameters. The URL itself is like a tree, and as well as all the parameters, and then we try to cluster all of the requests together based on this hierarchy.
For example, for A, which is a string, you can pass A as A0, A, A1, B2,
yes.
And something.
Yes. So that would be, that the parameters are part of this tree, so you would see that there is a lot of HTML responses that all map to the same, and I believe the request as well, that map to the same, they're only different in this one part, so you would cluster those together. But you need some heuristics based on how similar the rest of the parts are. The code is also open source, so you can dig into it, and then you can complain with Faiza about it, because she did her master's project building on this, so it's very complicated. It's not a brag, it's just a complicated stuff. So the idea here is that this page has a form with a post method to add.php, whereas these forms are all the same, but they differ in this ID parameter here. So we developed our clustering algorithm to cluster these together, but leave that one separately. So we ran our tool, we created this tool called Stateware Crawler against wget, skipfish, and w3af. So these are all open source tools. And w3af, the results are super interesting because we didn't create a new fuzzing engine. We used the exact same fuzzing capabilities of w3af. So we just crawled the application differently, and then once we had this graph of all the states of the application, we could test the application in every single one of those states. So we developed against a number of apps. One of the things I really like about this is that I think Vanilla Forms and Gallery were Ruby on Rails apps, so we weren't just testing on PHP apps. And this Wago Pico version 2 is because I had to kill some of the time-based functionality. So we could ignore that. But the WordPress stuff was all good. And then this was the key thing, is we're saying, like, okay, what we're doing is we're improving our vulnerability, we're improving the crawling engine, which the only thing that matters there is, are you executing more code? So we did use code coverage as our core metric here. And what we did is we used a baseline approach. So the other thing is, code coverage by itself is meaningless. If I say I cover 10% of the application's code, is that good, is that bad? It depends, is 90% of that in admin functionality? So what we did is we used wget, just like a recursive wget, which is the stupidest crawler you could ever write. That's not even a vulnerability analysis tool. We used that as our baseline. So we just said, what's the code coverage with wget? And then what do all these tools get above wget? So briefly, the results. So some interesting things to note here, that Skipfish, the green tool, actually had less code coverage than wget on something like WordPress. Yeah. Whereas, like, you can see some of the, you know, this PHP bulletin board, we had more than 100% increase in code coverage over wget. Wago Pico was obviously much better because the tool could log in already. It would create accounts and log in. Like, it was pretty cool. Yes.
You test your solution only, for the testing. Do you use any logs from the web server or even the skill server to check queries and how much
you
need to
do?
No,
you can't do that. That's cheating. That's not a
testing. No, for testing. That how much you dig into the code?
No, this is just code coverage numbers. But we did get, so we do have vulnerability metrics. We did find vulnerabilities that nobody else found. The other interesting thing is this is one of the graphs. So these graphs are actually incredibly complicated. Because the way we define state, it means that whenever you made a comment on, let's say, a picture on a website, you now literally fundamentally change the state of the application. And unless you can delete that comment, you can never go back. So we didn't create like a loop detection thing to say like, oh, this is actually fetching from, you know, whatever. But it does work, and it does increase the effectiveness here. So you have all these interesting login and logout functionalities based on, and there we had Wacko Pico have this cart functionality, so you could get pictures, add them to a cart. That's pretty cool. Anyways, I want to give you an overview of the research I've done, automated vulnerability analysis, and what kind of cool, interesting research areas there are. So I'm around.